So, good afternoon. Thank you for sharing your Saturday afternoon with us, with the session also, closing session. I would like to thank Jelena and Jana and all the team who made this possible. For me, it's very special to be back in Vienna because in 2007 also I lived here and I worked as an intern in Generali Foundation, so I have very good memories. So I'm very pleased to be able to have this discussion here today. I should go more towards... I would say like it is the presentation changed its shape for me in the meantime because we reached a new level of urgency in Turkey. And also when I'm speaking about togetherness, I would really like to speak about different groups who are proposing different models of togetherness that that I think working very actively in Turkey, but they're also pushed to being illegal as they are components of the Gezi uprising in 2013. Just as an maybe like a to frame, we reached a different moment in Turkey after 29th of October because there was an amendment to law saying that university chancellors cannot be elected by the academic staff anymore but should be directly appointed by state, like President Erdogan. And secondly, all the remaining Kurdish press agencies and newspapers are closed, alongside Evrensel Kültür, which is the first art and culture journal to be closed by such a law amendment. 2 days after that, there were detainments and imprisonments of the Cumhuriyet newspaper, which is also another social democrat base opposing government AKP's neoliberal policies and in open fight also. And 9 of Cumhuriyet writers and foundation members are imprisoned right now. And thirdly, you may have followed like the pro-Kurdish HDP party's co-leaders Demirtas and Yüksekdağ, alongside other MPs, are also imprisoned. I think the number is 10 right now. And thirdly, like yesterday we learned that the big law case that the state opened against Özgür Gündem, again a pro-Kurdish newspaper in Turkey, is asking for lifetime imprisonment for all the Özgür Gündem means liberated agenda in Turkish, in English, sorry, is also they're asking for a lifetime imprisonment, and among them are writers Aslı Erdoğan, a very important novelist, and also Necmi Alpay, an important linguist and human rights activist. So, of course, like this brings, since this is a direct attack, I would say, like to dismantle the components of the Gezi opposition, I reshaped my talk by to underline the agencies of these groups. I would like to open this presentation by saying of Paramaz Kızılbaş, aka Supi Nejat Ernaslı, Power of Imagination to Rule, which was part of a letter that he left to his mother when he was going to fight against Daesh in Kobane and killed in 2014. I think it's an important base to start. So we are We are passing through dark times, as conflicts whose seeds have been primarily planted by the colonial capitalism are erupting violently, leading to unlimited aggression and war in many parts of the world. And as the independent writer Robert Fisk quickly noted, ISIS was quick to understand a truth that the West must now confront, that the national borders imposed by colonial powers 100 years ago are becoming meaningless. Right-wing populism is one of the answers to the changing borders and the changing national citizenship. Democracy running without democrats, now as we see with examples all around the world, like Putin, Trump, Erdogan, Temer, and this occasion of Brexit. And on the other hand, we are also left with the question, who are really the last democrats, even in the older and sacred democracies in the European Union? Because many representatives keep on ignoring the political demands of thousands and millions and simply carrying on decisions that are triggering situations that are making things worse, like helping the global war frame, the refugee question, sales of weapons, and many also commerce contracts. And therefore, they are enabling the space for the likes like AfD, Orban, or Le Pen. So when national borders and the concepts of national citizenship and democracy are called into question like this, we have to rethink our primary categories of self, of development and their different representations and political implications. But how are we to replace to displace categories with the new ones? In other words, do we have the liberty or like the power to create something completely new amidst this ongoing fragmentation and destruction? The image that I'm showing is one of the, let's say, symbolic images from Gezi in 2013. A member of BDP, it's the pro-Kurdish party, along with another person who is holding a Turkish flag with Atatürk's image on it, which is a very Republican gesture, are actually hand in hand escaping from the police, police attack and police intervention, which is, I think, so critical also, again, to discuss, to look at it 3 years later. Another quote that I want to move on with in this case is what Lebanese poet and painter Etel Adnan wrote in the case of Brexit discussions. She said, "The world needs togetherness, not separation, love, not suspicion, a common future, not isolation." In such an environment, the togetherness transgresses its naivety and becomes an urgency, almost also provocation. The first time I myself dealt with the notion of togetherness curatorially was in 2013 when I created the Festival of Sofia Contemporary, and the title was Near Closer Together, Exercises by a Common Ground. Of course, 2013 was a year where there were a lot of demonstrations in Sofia against the political stagnation and unoperating or non-functioning democracy. And I, togetherness was there to address mainly the gaps between communities, like the miscommunication between communities and how they were not actually able to stand or form a stronger coalition against this stagnation. So for me, I'm in this talk, I'm very inspired by Okay, I'm very inspired by theories of Holly Lewis in a new book called The Politics of Everybody, where she's attempting to create an intersection between feminism, queer theory, and Marxism. So I look for certain examples that would that can move this discussion a little bit further. And as I said, these bodies are mainly there, these bodies who are pushed to be illegal against the policies of Turkish state. So in 2013 also it was, this is an image from the 2013 Pride Walk in Istanbul, just after Gezi solidarity, or let's say within the Gezi solidarity. Though 3 years is not a very long time, we are in such a different place in Turkey. And we think how to respond to a world that belongs to people now rebelling to the establishment to the elites that are rebelling against. And in that sense, solidarity must be understood as a political recognition that our futures are tied together rather than accentuating or accepting diversities. I feel like Holly Lewis's theory, like a provocative understanding of everybody, can provide us a very good ground. As I said, inspired by her proposition, there are two examples I would say with these two images that I would like to bring. Two positions that are working against the neoliberal impositions of the Turkish state, the renewed Turkish state, a new form of colonialism that we are experiencing. First is Kaos GL's activism of LGBTI that started in the early 90s, and the second is the Kurdish women movement that started in Turkey and now extended also to Rojava. But I really want to first discuss the Turkish counterpart, which I find it's more urgent to discuss right now also for me, that produced a new concept called genealogy, the science of women, which is very connected in my reading to the tradition of women solidarity guild that happened in the even before the Ottoman, called Bajiani Rum, which means the Greek sisters. So, as I said, these two groups were very active in the Gezi resistance, fighting against fundamentalist policies and fighting for a sort of universalism that coming from below to the universalism, to the attitude of universalism that was pushed by AKP's colonialist attitude from above. I find I would love to continue with this piece that's also produced interestingly, but also it's not a coincidence, at the same time when the women movement and also LGBTI association, Kaos GL, started or getting stronger in their own togetherness, there's this piece by Hale Tengar, which böyle tanıdıklarım means that I have acquaintances like this. This is one of the first art pieces where an artist was taken to court by the Turkish state for demeaning and underestimating the Turkish flag. But I would say this work is also standing or symbolizing so well what the LGBTI activism in Turkey and Kurdish women movement are standing against, which is this this very, very patriarchal, very male and very colonial attitude of Turkish state that has its phases but doesn't really change in essence. If I talk about the detail of the pieces, the piece is composed, as you see, this is a Turkish flag, and the piece is composed of two, two archaeological, this kind of little objects that are sold touristically. One is the Priapos, the symbol of maleness, and this is a kind of a very famous, gift object in Ephesus, in Izmir, where Hale comes from, and also the three monkeys, where they don't speak, they don't hear. So she combined these two elements, and for me, this is really also one of the most important pieces. That's talking about the nature of Turkish nationalism that hits us back and back and back again. So Kaos GL, Gay and Lesbian Cultural Studies and Solidarity Association, it became a legal body in 2015. But it was the first among like the different LGBTI groups to take a step to become an association in Turkey. It is started with a pamphlet magazine that became the first communication platform between gays and lesbians in Turkey. Then also it expanded also to the trans community. Right now, Kaos GL is a sort of mothership, not only like holding its own activities, but also helping also newer LGBTI groups in different cities in Turkey, and also different trans activists, like really giving them full support in terms of becoming a full functioning NGO. This is like the translation of this little note that started Kaos GL. So if I read it out loud, to all gays, lesbians, and anti-heterosexists, if you think you're alone, you're misled. We have existed and will continue to exist in every sphere of society. However, we have been forced to exist with identities heterosexism has offered us, with identities that define us. Hasn't the time come yet to change these identities? We have taken the first step and hired a pretty PO box. Our aim is to have a communication network and to meet with other people who went to march together. You can write to this PO box about your distress, your problems, and your feelings, and what you can do as an individual. Who else could we trust other than ourselves? Kaos GL's first magazines, if I can just like show you here. The first magazines are really like kind of black-white Xerox magazines. And it was mainly really a communication platform, also like important statement. From the very beginning, Kaos GL took a very, I would say, provocative steps in terms of combining queer theory and Marxism. One of the first public pamphlets that they distributed was the 1st of May. And also it was calling out for the homosexual workers. And it was the first time such a thing happened in Turkey, and also parts of the labor organizations that were protesting in Ankara in 2001 at that point were very surprised to have their presence, and they really didn't know what to do with this statement. Kaos came together in 1994, is the year same when Halle made the piece. I have acquaintances like this, as I said, who strongly believed only the freedom of the homosexuals can render heterosexuals free. So right now, Kaos is a major center supporting other activist groups, continuing to fight for legal rights in the constitution as much as is possible right now, and giving psychological consultation to the LGBTI individuals. One of the things that I kind of forgot to mention was also another thing that happened within these days was 370 associations are closed again by this amendment in states. And still we don't know exactly which associations are closed unless police are at their door. So of course we are also afraid of the existence or afraid of the position of the Kaos GL, who are already, of course, as you can imagine, they are receiving death threats from different groups. So this was the point when Kaos GL distributed the pamphlet that I was telling you about. This is from like the 2001 1st of May, March. As a magazine that started with this little pamphlet that you see, it was like put into, because of its content, it was put into, in Turkey we call it like put in the, like bagged, it became bagged, like or put into like envelope like this. in 2000, but by this time the magazine got really big and also got a very national distribution, national and international, I would say. And not interestingly, of course, the recent, this is the very recent of Chaos GL, this is like the state of the magazine right now. And the last folder, or like their last topic, is queer Marxism for their 150th edition. A very good chance was being proposed like to make an exhibition in Istanbul this year for the 20th year anniversary of Chaos GL. And we went through all of the archive material and anything we find. And luckily, like Chaos GL is a very good archiving group, so there were really very beautiful materials that, like some even smallest like support letters, cards from prisons, or like solidarity like packages coming from different LGBTI organizations around the world that we were able like to put into display with different artists who published the works of different artists who published their folders in Chaos GL magazine. So just to say, like, to make such an exhibition also the beginning in 2016 was possible. I really don't know if it's possible to do this exhibition again. Our exhibition is called Future Queer. And also as a model, like, of the togetherness and alliance, I think this the piece that you showed from Erin Seyman is also very important. I would say it's very important also like to say here that LGBTI activism was never like mainly or only discussing the issues of gender in Turkey. It's like from the very beginning it was a discussion of the class, it was a discussion of like the militarism, it was a discussion of nationalism. So it is also always very difficult like to describe the queer space in Turkey in that sense, since it is very multi-layered. And it already like created its own togetherness and solidarity network in the line of the model that I want to propose today, the intersection between Marxism, feminism, and queer theory. So The second part that I would like to speak about is like from the women's movement. This is a 2003 poster that was, of course, banned by the state at the time. 2009. You can really see that all of the components standing behind it was a post. It was a poster for the 8th of March. And the groups like behind that you can see, and all of the different like socialist and also LGBTI platforms alongside Association of Human Rights or like the Guild of Architects and Engineers. So the Kurdish women movement always like saw itself in a line that kind of starts from Rosa Luxemburg to now. And also another important figure is Sakine Cansız, a co-founder of PKK, who was assassinated in Paris in, I think, 2013. So I find the concept of genealogy, the science of women, is a very interesting topic. So as you see, this is like the first conference that the group, now they constantly change names also to fight with the police, but the coalition of democratic and liberated women. So this was a conference of the Middle Eastern women discussing basically how to fight the patriarchal model of the Middle Eastern countries, the Middle Eastern base, and how it's actually like the women of the Middle East find a different sort of commonality between them. And all, and the conference was involving really different groups, like women from Palestine, women from Syria, from Afghanistan, from Pakistan, and it was even extending until also Azerbaijan. And though there were also like components who wanted to come from Armenia, it was very difficult for them to come, and they couldn't. Here you can see Gülten Kışanak. She's also in prison right now because she was one of the co-mayors of Diyarbakır, and with her co-mayor, they are both in prison. She's giving a talk in this first conference. These conferences are continuing still, and I was able to find really the quick documents. Cologne conference that happened in 2014, and also Paris conference that happened recently in 2016. Though it kind of changed shape and is directly right now talking, or like trying to bring different voices into the discussion of genealogy, the science of women, where Kurdish women see it as an ongoing debate, not something like a, not a kind of a notion that is like already finished. And they would like to also create a different universalism through this concept. It is mainly, of course, claims to fill the space that's left by the Western feminism. And this open proposal understands science as a social entity. And trying to overcome the positivist attitude which it claims to weaken the position of women in a class-based society. It's not a coincidence that it started as a Middle Eastern women conference. Of course, the Kurds right now, they want to create this different space in the politics of Middle East, which is getting more difficult, but I think which will become successful in the end. Bringing together like all these kind of different claims, like for example, how despite like how difficult it is for Arab-speaking activists and Kurdish-speaking activists to come together, they really want to bring together this platform. So I would love to. I would love to directly quote from like the genealogy conference in Cologne, also to open it into a sort of debate, if you would love to really like see the approach. The Cologne conference in 2014 was formed of topics such as distorted history, distortion of identities, epistemology of science, construction of a science that excludes women from life, feminism, the rebellion of the earliest colony, genealogy, the reconstruction of the sciences towards a communal and free life. So, and their manifesto, like it's another very long one, I think it's important to read here also. The crisis which has been caused by the patriarchal capitalist system has become obvious in many ways. Not only the financial crisis, but also ecological crisis and social crisis are affecting and threatening people's lives all over the world. Due to the patriarchal character of state societies, capitalist economy, positivist ideologies, religions and sciences, women are hit by the crisis in multiple ways. The urgent need for social alternatives that are not based on oppression, hierarchies and marginalization has been expressed by social movements and women's movements throughout the last decades. While criticizing the destruction of the dominant system, women also have been involved in the development of alternatives and struggles for change. Against this context, we are calling for the conference Radical Thinking from the Women's Perspective, Genealogy. By the means of this conference, we are striving to dismantle the irreality of a patriarchal positivist scientific approach that has distorted history and identities by exclusion and colonization of women. At the same time, we are looking forward to share and discuss alternative concepts of women's sciences which can contribute to the establishment of a free, democratic, ecological society. An alternative understanding of science is not only a theoretical approach but also linked to the struggle for liberation and social transformation. Yeah, I find that this is kind of a quite important statement, and I find it also they're trying to create this base, really trying to create this intersections between different theories to be enable a different sort of communality or like togetherness that even didn't happen that much around like the feminism, because of course most of the feminist lines that didn't really find their space in the Middle East because it was still coming from a white and colonial background at the end of the day. I would say like the implications, there are of course like the actual implications of like the women reflected of this movement reflected in Turkey. I would say like one of the first one is like the southeastern municipalities in co-chairs, always men and women, which is something that they try to like implicate in Turkey as well. Right now, most of these also municipalities are suspended or put into prison. But I would love to like share again like the Diyarbakir, the co-chair mayors, as like a kind of a significant example. And of course, another thing was this is a really beautiful picture from like the post-election of 2015, where Turkish parliament reached like the most, the highest level of women parliamentarians in its history. There were 31 women parliamentarians elected from HDP party, and there were also like other parties, in also Republican People's Party as well. And these women that you see here, they weren't even able to work or like operate in the parliament because the elections are cancelled, I would say like in 2 weeks. And actually these women, they couldn't find their space in the parliament, and ever since we are living in a hell situation that is extending its violence every day. Of course, I mean, looking at this like outside, this is not only like coming as a kind of political party. Of course, from the early point on, after Öcalan's writings, these women organizations were very strong inside PKK. And also afterwards, like there were women's academies like founded in different cities, again mainly in Diyarbakir, like also developing like the earlier stages of genealogy ideas. Of course, right now, like when in the West, when people or like when Western press looks at the women like fighting in Rojava, they don't, since they are not really interested in like the genealogy of these ideas, they kind of see it as if it happened all of a sudden, or as it has a kind of recent development, though it has really like deep roots that kind of extends like from Turkey on. You can really see this is like a recent magazine that's produced with the name Genealogy, and like those two other conferences that I have been mentioning. Also, the interesting thing is that most of this publication material that you find online and in print, they are Turkish materials. Though I have to say, like in Turkey, they are never discussed because, like from the like by default, they are identify as a separatist group. So even like the feminist groups in Turkey, they are not even able to, or like they don't want to look at this material since it's already like illegal from its foundation for them. So I find this really beautiful also, from one of the blogs that I really wanted to share. So this is also, I would say, the handwork is a really beautiful expression of how, you know, Kurdish woman movement sees itself. It sees itself in a direct connection with the world. It's not really about only Kurdish nationalism. It's something also going beyond the borders of Kurdish nationalism, as it's often discussed in Turkey. So of course, I would share also some images as an extension of this discussion, like the beautiful organizations in Rojava. We should also mention, of course, because it's going to parallel and part of the war that is ongoing right now in Turkey is because of the success of the movement in Rojava. Turkish state is very afraid that the Kurdish cities in Turkey will create a similar sort of autonomy and try to separate themselves. But this is also on the day where Kobani was saved from ISIS. What I find also very beautiful is actually this is like one of the rare images that you can find from Bajiani Rum discussion. It's one of this kind of really like not touched point in Turkish, like let's say pre-Islam like history. Because they are in between, let's say, like pagan and Islam period of the Turkic societies, and they really like they are the first organization in that sense, like a kind of guild, working and educating women to tell about their, to ensure them about their economic freedom, their position in the society, also teaching them how to fight. And how to educate their children, and this is one of the like leaders like in the group. I hope to be able to go a little bit more into topic because I find like this genealogy very important. That how actually like these two groups, despite like centuries in between them, exist, and there is a kind of a communication maybe also like to be put between them. I didn't put here, but also there is another like mythological base saying that Amazonians are also coming from the northeast part of Turkey, mainly based in the northeast part of Turkey, and it's another warrior woman tribe. But I find like the guild, like the structure of Bajiani Rum, much more important in terms of, again, a different model of solidarity and togetherness today. I would like to, like, in terms of extending just like this little thread that you saw in this image, I wanted to extend, like, to level of solidarity and want to mention, like, two important sites that you may have followed from social media. This is, like, the Gezani process that happened in Poland against like the abortion law, the women like struck and got together. And in very similar time, I would say like within maybe like 2 weeks, there was also another very big demonstration that happened in Argentina, in Buenos Aires. This is Plaza de Mayo, and Ni Una Menos was a big demonstration again like for women all around Argentina against male violence. Just like to connect all of these struggles together and to like really like remind ourselves again, despite all the darkness, actually these movements are not disconnected from each other, and then we will be able to create a new form of, there are possibilities to create a new form of solidarity and togetherness. And as for my final, I would like to commemorate again the students who were killed in an ISIS bombing in last year, in 2015, and which was, let's say, like, it was just after the election and it was signing the beginning of the war in Turkey. And these were like the really young people coming from different classes, coming from, I would say, different ideals, a lot of young women that you see. I would love to commemorate, like, to the idea of togetherness to them. I'm still emotional about this. Thank you.